use that as a segue for introducing our next speaker, Dr. Ashwani Bedi, because when he was in his home country of India, he was a nationally ranked basketball player. So he's a guy that can do some hoops as well as some EP. He received his physician's degree at Punjab University, and then did his residency in New York at New York Methodist Hospital, clinical fellowship in cardiology at the University of Missouri, and then did his electrophysiology at Mayo, and then spent the next number of years in Illinois running an EP program. And we're very fortunate to have had him move to California and join our group. Ash is a very steady hand, very easy guy to talk to. Patients love him, and he does an excellent job, especially with atrial fibrillation. And he's going to speak to us this morning. Ash?
Thanks, Dr. Dunlap. Thanks for the kind intro. So we're going to talk about atrial fibrillation and what we are trying to strive for. It's a very progressive field, and as we all know that atrial fibrillation is the most common cause for hospitalization, not only in the United States, but in the world. I wish we have a drug, atrial fibrillomab, which can some form of immunotherapy, and next year I'll be talking more about that. So I have no disclosures, so we all had a break the second session, so I want you to put your seat belts on, take your seats, you know, and call it this way, but I want you to stay in your seats because we just took a break, and trespassers will be shot, survivors will be shot again. So I'm just kidding, guys. Thank you. So we're going to talk about different aspects of atrial fibrillation management, types of atrial fibrillation, because that really affects the prognosis and the treatment. What kind of atrial fibrillation it is. You know, it's not just AFib. We have so many different types. I've been ordered not to talk about anticoagulation by Dr. Brayton. So you're going to hear a wonderful talk from Dr. Brayton about anticoagulation, so I'm not going to be talking about that. We'll discuss treatment options. Dr. Coleman talked briefly about appendage occlusion, and we'll talk a little more about it, ablative treatments, hybrid approaches to atrial fibrillation, and importance of tailored approach. If you look at atrial fibrillation, it is four different types. I call it paroxysmal, when AFib terminates on its own within 7 days. Excuse me, JP, I cannot see the talk right here. Okay, on the program, okay. So if AFib terminates within 7 days, it's paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. If it is more than, if it's lasting more than 7 days, it's persistent. Why is it important? Because there are changes in the atrium. It's not just based on something firing and causing atrial fibrillation. Slowly what happens is there are changes in the atrium or electrical remodeling, then mechanical remodeling, which cause atrial fibrillation to stay in there. So it's more advanced disease. Then we have long-standing persistent atrial fibrillation, where the AFib is present for more than 12 months. Permanent AFib. The term permanent AFib is used when the clinician and the patient make a joint decision that they're not going to try to get back to normal rhythm. You know, because it's almost impossible to get back to normal rhythm. We have had patients who've been shocked multiple times. They don't even convert, even for a second or so. So then there is new thing about non-valvular AFib. Why is it important? Because of these newer anticoagulation strategies. These are the AFib in the absence of any rheumatic mitral stenosis or any mechanical or bioprosthetic heart valve or mitral valve repair. Though this is changing, I must say there will be new studies coming in that some of these newer anticoagulation medications can be potentially used. So right now, we are not talking about it. Cardiovascular morbidity and mortality associated with atrial fibrillation, we all know that there is increased mortality, increased risk of stroke. If we look at quality of life, AFib affects quality of life in almost all the patients. You know, the symptoms of fatigue, tiredness, shortness of breath, dizziness, and they just don't have a PAP in there. Even the patients who are saying that they don't have any symptoms, when we convert them and then they go back to atrial fibrillation, they can easily tell the difference that they're, I was feeling a lot better. It can cause left ventricular dysfunction and heart failure. A lot of our patients who are coming in, you know, they have either heart dysfunction or mechanical dysfunction because of AFib, or vice versa. There is a heart failure which is contributing to atrial fibrillation. There have been reports about cognitive decline in patients, not just because of recurrent strokes and vascular dementia, but independently, atrial fibrillation has affected their cognitive functions. If you look at mechanisms of atrial fibrillation, there are so many different factors that could be contributing to. There could be a fibrosis in the atrium, dilatation of the atrium, there is ischemia, inflammation, hypertrophy, all could be contributing. So in other words, there is atrial remodeling, which is contributing to atrial fibrillation. Some of these patients have channel problems, ion channel problems. There is, if you guys have heard about sudden cardiac death in some patients with channelopathies, there is a long QT or short QT. Some of these channel problems can contribute to atrial fibrillation too. How about RAS activation, renin angiotensin activation system? I'm sorry. Right here. That has been implicated in the atrial remodeling. So if we are treating these patients well with angiotensin receptor blockers and ACE inhibitors, there have been regression, or this would delay the progression of atrial fibrillation, I would say. We have to make sure we are treating the hypertension well and treating the risk factors for atrial fibrillation, and talk more about it in the tailored approach. What is the diagnostic yield of ECG? So when we do a ECG or EKG in a patient, it just gives us a 6-second rhythm on that patient who's been complaining of palpitations or who may be totally asymptomatic. You know, I've seen Dr. Dunlap doing those link loop recorders in these patients, which almost have 100% sensory picking up atrial fibrillation. So depending upon what modality we are using, easier it is to diagnose atrial fibrillation. If we are doing Holter monitors, the chance of picking atrial fibrillation is less than 4%. If you're doing an extended event monitor, chance of picking atrial fibrillation goes up a little bit. And in implantable devices, you know, almost 100% efficacy. So we have a device which is called as a link loop recorder, very easily implanted, and can diagnose atrial fibrillation in almost all patients, especially patients who have some symptoms and Holters and monitors are not helping. So screening is very important. You know, based on the guidelines, these are the new European Society guidelines which just came in. They're a little more advanced than our ACC guidelines, which were there in 2014. Screening for AFib is recommended by pulse taking or ECG rhythm strip in patients more than 65 years of age. In patients with TIA or ischemic stroke, screening for AFib is recommended by short-term ECG recording followed by continuous ECG monitoring for at least 72 hours. It is also recommended to interrogate pacemakers and ICDs on a regular basis for atrial high rate episodes. These days we have tons of patients who have pacemakers or defibrillators, and we find that they have atrial high rate episodes. When is it significant to call it an atrial fibrillation? 1 minute, 2 minute, 5 hours, 24 hours? You know, there has been a big debate. The consensus recently has been if they have AFib more than 5 to 6 minutes on the device, then you have to start the anticoagulation, whether aspirin or the newer anticoagulation medications based on their the ischemic risks or the stroke risk. If we look at the clinical types of atrial fibrillation, it may be secondary to some structural heart disease. We call it focal atrial fibrillation. You know, these are patients with paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. There could be polygenic. There are so many different genes that could be responsible for atrial fibrillation. Postoperative atrial fibrillation, these are the atrial fib which happens in post-bypass patients, post-valve surgery patients. These are usually transient, about 70 to 80% of them, they go back to normal sinus rhythm at 3 months. So we usually treat them for 3 months. After that, you don't see atrial fibrillation. But if it is persistent, that means there was a problem with atrial fibrillation even before that was undiagnosed. Atrial fibrillation related to mitral stenosis or prosthetic valves, that is more like valvular AFib. AFib in athletes, it's usually paroxysmal. And it is related to duration and intensity of the training of atrial fib. So these athletes, they're coming in with atrial fibrillation, overtrained. They've been doing really well, running decathlons and running marathons, but they are having atrial fibrillation. So we call it more like a vagal mediated. They have a very high vagal tone, and that's vagal mediated AFib. Sometimes there are channelopathies, as I mentioned. So these are different clinical types of atrial fibrillation. What we previously discussed were the types of atrial fibrillation depending upon the duration of atrial fibrillation. Based on this, I already talked about, based on high rate atrial episodes, we treat atrial fibrillation if it is more than 5 to 6 minutes on the device. Trust me, devices, they give us a lot more information than just working as pacemakers or defibrillators. They are the great diagnostic tools. They are the monitors. And if we are finding AFib, a lot of these patients are placed on anticoagulation or rate control medications or antiarrhythmics, and we are looking at their devices for responses to the treatment too. So for the management, the most important initial management for atrial fibrillation is, do we need to cardiovert the patient? You know, if patient is unstable, that they are having heart failure, it's best to just cardiovert the patients. Sometimes, depending upon the stroke risk, we have to anticoagulate those patients. So in the beginning, you know, they come in for atrial fibrillation with RVR, some heart failure, we always try to anticoagulate those patients. We try to normalize the heart failure symptoms. Control their heart rates. The most important goal for atrial fibrillation management is, one, control the heart rate, make sure you mitigate the stroke risk or give them anticoagulation. And then based on their symptoms, we treat atrial fibrillation, whether to get them back in normal rhythm or we can keep them in atrial fibrillation. These are patients with long-standing atrial fibrillation. But initially, if somebody is coming in with heart failure, already presenting with symptoms, we usually try to get them in sinus rhythm as early as possible. We try to inhibit the renin-angiotensin system by giving them ACE inhibitors or ARBs, treating their blood pressures well. If patients in atrial fibrillation, it is better to get them back in normal rhythm as early as possible. So sometimes we just try to slow down the heart rate and let them live with atrial fibrillation. So we have a saying called as AFib begets atrial fibrillation. If AFib is present, it tends to promote more atrial fibrillation. It's a progressive disease. So there should be early consideration for a rhythm control in these patients with atrial fibrillation. We also start the advanced heart failure therapies in these patients who are presenting with the LV dysfunctions, and treatment of cardiovascular disease is equally important, especially ischemia, which may be contributing. Somebody just talked about they diagnosed metastatic cancer when the patient presented with atrial fibrillation too. We usually follow an integrated approach to improve the life expectancy and improve the quality of life in patients with atrial fibrillation. So rate control, lifestyle changes, treatment of underlying cardiovascular disease are very important. Rhythm control in patients who are very symptomatic with atrial fibrillation, and that includes cardioversion, ablation, or surgery for atrial fibrillation. The CHA₂DS2 score is recommended for stroke risk. It's a level one, class one recommendation, which we use routinely. We also assess the bleeding risk for these patients in deciding what anticoagulation we have to go for. Other than that, I'm not supposed to talk about anticoagulation. Facts about atrial fibrillation: we know that it's the most common cardiac arrhythmia. Affects more than 3 million individuals in the US. It's projected to increase to 16 million by 2050. Patients with AF have a five-fold higher risk of stroke. Over 80%, 87% of the strokes are thromboembolic. Greater than 90% of the thrombus accumulation originates in the left atrial appendage. Stroke is the number one cause of long-term disability and third leading cause of death in patients with atrial fibrillation. We all know about the challenges with warfarin, narrow therapeutic index, interaction with some foods and medications, and required frequent monitoring and dosage adjustments. Published reports indicate that less than 50% of the patients eligible are being treated with warfarin due to tolerance or non-compliance issues. The previously reported sportive trial suggested that 60% of the patients are treated within a therapeutic INR range, and 29% have INRs below 2.0, and 15% have INRs above 3.0. Dr. Coleman talked about the left atrial appendage occluders. I'm gonna talk about it a little bit. This is the lariat device right here. This is done through apicardial approach, so we access the pericardium through a subcostal stake, and you pass a wire, and it's a magnetic wire which gets in contact with another wire placed through right atrium, crossing the septum into the left atrium, and then into the appendage right here. This is done under transesophageal echo guidance. These are the pacing wires in that patient. And by just connecting those two wires, you can clip that appendage by introducing a lariat device where you can occlude the appendage at the base of the appendage there. So it is done under transesophageal echo guidance. We are planning to start that process in Memorial and here in Santa Rosa within the next year or so. We are first trying the TAVR program, and the next would be to introduce Watchman and lariat devices later on. So there are other kind of devices. We talked about there is Watchman here, there is occluder here, and there is an ACP device, which is not being used very commonly now. We briefly talked about a Watchman device. This was reported in 2015. LA closure technology is designed to prevent embolization of thrombi that may form in the left atrial appendage. The Watchman left atrial appendage closure technology is an alternative. I must say it's an alternative to warfarin therapy for patients with non-valvular atrial fibrillation. So this is the Watchman device for left atrial appendage. If you look, this is the appendage. This is the base of the appendage. This is again introduced from the right atrium and through a transseptal approach going to the left atrium. We routinely place catheters in the left atrial appendage when we are doing atrial fibrillations too. So this is a relatively easier procedure and less riskier than the lariat. So as we are getting more and more familiar with the lariat, which is an epicardial delivery system, you know, things will get go in a different direction. But right now, more and more centers are doing the Watchman device. This was the study reported that it was a non-inferiority trial that they looked at the stroke risk with Watchman versus Coumadin. So Watchman patients, the stroke was less, and it was primarily the hemorrhagic stroke, but it was not considered inferior to Coumadin. So that's what led to the approval, because this has been studied for the last 10 years. So finally, the FDA approved it because it was considered non-inferior based on this trial, and there was a decrease in the hemorrhagic stroke risk at 6 months with the Watchman, because patients were allowed to discontinue Coumadin after about 45 days of Watchman device. So in the way, it's not that you can use in place of Coumadin, it's for patients who are intolerant to Coumadin because of different problems, because even after Watchman device, they have to take Coumadin for about 6 to 8 weeks, and then you can stop the Coumadin and cut down the bleeding risk. So if we look at different subgroups, whether it is age, sex, CHAD score, Hasblad score, it was kind of neutral, not significant, so it was considered non-inferior to Coumadin based on responses in different subgroups of the patients. This led to the incorporation of this PROTECT AF trial in the new guidelines too, that you can, based on the PROTECT AF trial, the guidelines are implicating that Watchman device can be used for patients who are intolerant to Coumadins or warfarins. What about antiarrhythmic medications for atrial fibrillation? We have so many different antiarrhythmic medications, starting from amiodarone, dofetilide, dronedarone, flecainide, propafenone, and sotalol, that have been used for atrial fibrillation. They are on class 1 indications for patients who have symptomatic atrial fibrillation. You have to assess the risk of antiarrhythmic drugs, including proarrhythmia, when you are starting the antiarrhythmic medication. A lot of these drugs cannot be used in certain group of patients. Based on their potential toxicities, amiodarone should be used only after consideration of risk and when other agents have failed or are contraindicated, because it has so many side effects. A rhythm control strategy with pharmacological therapy can be useful in patients with atrial fibrillation for the treatment of tachycardia-induced cardiomyopathy. It may be reasonable to continue current antiarrhythmic drug therapy in the setting of infrequent, well-tolerated recurrences of atrial fibrillation when the drug has reduced the frequency. So what it means is there are patients who are on antiarrhythmics. It is not that these medications are completely taking care of atrial fibrillation, but it has made the atrial fibrillation more tolerable to the patient. So their episodes are less, they are less frequent, and there is less load of atrial fibrillation, so these medications can be used in those patients too. So antiarrhythmics for rhythm control should not be used when the AFib becomes permanent. When we have accepted that AFib is permanent, that there is nothing working, then these drugs should be contraindicated. Also, there is a recommendation in the 2014 guidelines. The reason I put this slide in there, because I see a lot of patients on dronedrone. It should not be used for treatment of AF in patients with NYHA class 3 and 4 or patients who have had an episode of decompensated heart failure in the past 4 weeks. Based on the guidelines, we can use certain medications in certain subgroup of patients. If patient does not have any structural heart disease, we can use dofetilide, flecainide, propafenone, or even sotalol. They can straight go for catheter ablation too based on the newest guidelines. If we find a young patient who has symptomatic atrial fibrillation, they can straight go for ablation. They don't have to be treated with antiarrhythmics. If patient has structural heart disease, for example, coronary artery disease, drugs like flecainide and propafenone are contraindicated because they can increase the risk of ventricular arrhythmias. So we have to be really careful about using the medications in this group of patients. A lot of our patients have coronary artery disease, and they can only be treated with dofetilide, sotalol, or dronedrone, and sometimes with amiodarone. They can have catheter ablation, or if patients have heart failure, dofetilide is probably the best drug for atrial fibrillation management. Problem with dofetilide is that you require hospitalization for 3 nights to start the medication. So it is becoming more and more cumbersome because of limitation on beds and very hard to start the medication. There's always a shortage of beds in the area here. If we look at the catheter ablation for sinus rhythm maintenance, AF ablation is used for symptomatic paroxysmal AF, refractory to or intolerant to at least one class 1 or class 3 medication. That means if patient has failed one antiarrhythmic and they have symptomatic atrial fibrillation, they are class 1 indications for atrial fibrillation ablation. Before consideration of AF ablation, assessment of procedural risks and the outcomes should be discussed with the individual patients. And you can tailor this strategy depending upon what kind of atrial fibrillation they have, whether it is paroxysmal, persistent, chronic, or I would say long persistent or permanent AFib. AF catheter ablation may be considered for symptomatic long-standing, more than 12 months, persistent AFib patients refractory to antiarrhythmics when other rhythm control medications are not working and rhythm control is desired. That means if patients with the long persistent AFib have symptomatic atrial fibrillation and medications are not working, you can consider atrial fibrillation ablation, but it's a class 2B indication. AF catheter ablation may also be considered before initiation of antiarrhythmic drug with class 1 or class 3 antiarrhythmic medications for symptomatic patients with persistent, that is, if they have more than 6 to 7 days of atrial fibrillation when a rhythm control strategy is desired. This is again a class 2B indication based on 2014 guidelines. Let's skip this. How about the surgical maze procedure? Based on the 2014 guidelines, all AF surgical ablation procedure is reasonable for selected patients with atrial fibrillation undergoing cardiac surgery for their indications. A standalone AF surgery ablation procedure may be reasonable for selected patients with highly symptomatic AF, not well managed with other approaches. So if patients have undergone AF ablation and they are still having persistent symptomatic atrial fibrillation, you can consider a standalone MACE procedure. But usually, surgical MACE procedure is indicated for patients who are undergoing surgery for valve or coronary artery disease problems. I have to talk about atrial flutter here. This typical atrial flutter, we have a sawtooth pattern on the EKG. When we look at the, this is a little busier slide, these are the electrograms. What we look at in the atrial flutter, we put catheters in the heart, the right atrium, and what we see here is very fast signals. This is going at almost 200 paper speed, and you see this flutter waves, which are like local signals, they are going at almost 300 beats per minute. But because we are recording it so fast, we can see the separation of these signals. If you look at the EKG on this, you will have a sawtooth pattern in there. So this arrhythmia is very amenable to ablative treatment, and almost 95 to 98% success rate for atrial flutter. So what we have to do in most of the patients is there is an ablation done between the tricuspid annulus and the inferior vena cava, which is that area is responsible for almost 100% of these typical atrial flutters. And this procedure has 95 to 98% success rate, and patients can be off anticoagulation. So this is the same for patients with the atrial flutter. Antithrombotic therapy is same as atrial fib, very important. And the cavotricuspid isthmus ablation, or what we call atrial flutter ablation, is a class one indication. If they are failing antiarrhythmic or as a first line therapy for atrial flutter management. So we don't have to try cardioversions, we don't have to try antiarrhythmics, they can straight go for atrial flutter ablation based on these guidelines. Atypical flutter, what is that? Atypical flutter is the one which is not coming from that area, so it has to be mapped. Many times these are more seen after the atrial fib ablation. These are the short circuits happening in the left atrium or the right atrium, and they can happen after any surgical procedure or after atrial fib ablation. And they can be either treated with the medications, they can be treated with the ablational or cardioversion, or you know, we have different strategies to treat depending upon the patient's symptoms. I already talked about AFib begets atrial fibrillation. We talked about atrial fibrillation causing atrial electrophysiological changes, we call it remodeling, that promotes the occurrence and maintenance of atrial fibrillation. There are triggers of atrial fibrillation. These usually come from the pulmonary veins. And then there are rotors, which are the rapidly revolving wavefronts, which occur in the atrium and cause persistent atrial fibrillation. So in the beginning, when the patient has paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, they have trigger-mediated, more triggers causing AFib, and these are coming from the pulmonary veins. But as the atrial fibrillation advances, there are more wavefronts happening in the atrium, so there is more and more atrial incorporation and involvement, and so there are more changes, and patients have persistent or chronic atrial fibrillation. This gets more and more difficult to control when they have persistent and chronic or permanent atrial fibrillation. We briefly talked about it. In the beginning, it's the trigger-mediated atrial fibrillation, and later on, as the disease advances, there are more substrate mediation, more rotors causing maintenance of atrial fibrillation there. It has been proposed that about 70 to 75% of the AFib triggers are located in and around the pulmonary vein. This is the back view of the heart. This is the left atrium. These are the four pulmonary veins that are bringing oxygenated blood from the lungs to the heart. And right atrium is on this side. This is the aorta, pulmonary artery. These pulmonary veins have been implicated in the causation of AFib in about 70 to 75% of the patients. Other patients, it could be the atrial tissue, or it could be there are superior vena cava, vein of Marshall, which is a vein that it's a remnant of left-sided SVC that goes right here in this area and joins the coronary sinus, and that have been implicated in the causation of atrial fibrillation. So the goal for atrial fibrillation ablation is isolation of these veins, That means electrically isolating the veins from rest of the heart. How is it achieved? We can do that. This is the endocardial map. You have all these veins opening up. These are the multiple wavelet hypothesis, where there are multiple rotors, or there could be a focal area of trigger which is causing atrial fibrillation there. So this, what we do in EP world is we incorporate the CT images. Patients get CT scans done. We can extract the left atrium from that CT scan of the chest and get images like this. We can create an image inside the heart. It's a three-dimensional image of the heart that is created by moving the catheter in the left atrium. And then we can combine these two images to almost less than 1 millimeter accuracy that we know where exactly our catheter position is. So many different circuits. What happens is these pulmonary veins, they have electrically active muscle fibers at the origin of these pulmonary veins, which can potentially cause atrial fibrillation. They can fire so fast, sometimes 400 to 500 beats per minute, and that goes to the atrial tissue and cause atrial fibrillation. So the goal of AFib ablation is to just isolate these veins from rest of the heart so that these electrical signals cannot go to the heart there. There are different kind of ablation approaches, from pulmonary vein isolation to wide area circumferential ablation, fractionated electrogram ablation, firm mapping. You know, we hear a lot about Stanford firm mapping. You know, that's a different way of doing the atrial fibrillation ablation. So pulmonary vein isolation, what we do is we put a little circular catheter in the pulmonary vein and cauterize around the orifices of these pulmonary veins to achieve isolation in there. So make sure that none of the electrical signals from the veins can come to rest of the heart. This is more like a wide area circumferential ablation, where you ablate around the orifices of these veins, and then we do ablation lines. This is a line from the left-sided inferior pulmonary vein to the mitral annulus, and this is the line on the posterior wall of the left atrium. This is the same picture. This is done on the CT. This is one of my patients who had ablation done. So essentially, these are the veins, and we are ablating on the outside of the veins and also doing the ablation lines in there. So you can see the ablation lines done. These are the lines, posterior wall line and the mitral line there. I would have to skip some slides in the interest of time. And there are different strategies for persistent AFib. You can do PVI alone. PVI alone plus CAFE means there are fractionated signals in different areas. PVI is pulmonary vein isolation, and this is pulmonary vein isolation plus ablation of some fractionated signals, and then PVI or pulmonary vein isolation plus lines. These have been used, but what we found out is that PVI alone has the best success rate for doing these, taking care of these patients with persistent atrial fibrillation, because more ablation we do, sometimes we are causing more arrhythmias there too. Overall success rate for patients with atrial fibrillation nearly approaches 70%. Patients with paroxysmal AFib, 70 to 80%. Patients with persistent AF, the success rate with AFib alone, one procedure, is about 60%, and higher with medications plus ablation. So some of these patients, they keep on having atrial fibrillation, and then we resort to other means like surgery or hybrid procedures. In the interest of time, I have to skip some slides here, but I'll talk about cryoablation. This is the different way of taking care of pulmonary vein isolation. This is where I showed you the previous slide, where we put a catheter in the pulmonary vein and cauterize around the orifices of these veins. With cryoablation, we have a cryoballoon that goes at the ostium of this vein, and then we freeze and use actually nitrous oxide and freeze around the orifice of these veins, and we are seeing great results with that too. So previously, we were doing a lot more ablations. Since 2012 and 13, more and more cryoablation is being done because the lesion set is more permanent and less problems, less hospitalizations, less arrhythmias in patients after cryoablation because the lesions are more uniform. When we look at the primary safety endpoints, which were the arrhythmia episodes, whether it is atrial flutter or atrial fib reoccurrence, and the safety endpoints of complications, they were less with the cryoablation, though it was not statistically significant. So with cryoablation, less problems than radio frequency, but it was not approaching statistical significance. All these AFib ablations do have complications that can be anywhere from groin issues to risks of pulmonary vein stenosis, nerve injuries, stroke, and connection between the heart and food pipe. These are theoretical complications. We take all precautions that these problems don't happen, but these are discussed with the patient when we go for atrial fibrillation ablation. I will briefly talk about hybrid procedures and then we'll end. This is the isolated pulmonary vein. What we are doing here is this is the left atrium and we are measuring the voltages. Gray means the scar area. After ablation, you have seen that all these veins are scarred off, so means they are electrically isolated from the rest of the heart. This is what we strive for of atrial fibrillation because we want to create a scar tissue around the pulmonary vein so electrical signals cannot come from the veins to the rest of the heart. This is a convergent approach which we will be starting with Dr. Deek in the next few months. What he likes to do is going from the subcostal area, going under the heart and ablate on the outside of the posterior wall and trying to achieve the isolation of just the posterior wall. And then as electrophysiologists, we have to go in there and isolate those veins where there are still electrical voltages. That would be started in near future. This is a convergent procedure. We are already doing thoracoscopic procedures where we get access through the chest wall and try to isolate these veins, and that is also done by surgeons, not by electrophysiologists. So this is just showing pre-ablation map of the left atrium, and this is after the convergent procedure, and this is after both convergent and ablation. You can see the whole posterior wall is grayed out and it's scarred off, and you are basically taking care of a lot of these electrical signals that are causing atrial fibrillation. This is the type of catheter that is, this is the catheter that is used. It goes through the subcostal approach under the heart, and then it's used to ablate on the back wall of the heart for isolating or creating a scar tissue in there. I had a movie about that. I would just quickly skip to the integrated approach where we involve the patient. They are fully advised, they're involved, they're educated, and that's how we make the decision and go for atrial fibrillation, whether it is catheter-based or whether it is surgical. We use multidisciplinary teams working together in a multidisciplinary chronic AFib care teams. You have people involved in different, we have Coumadin clinics, we have arrhythmia doctors, we have device cleaning people. They all work in unison to take care of these atrial fibrillation patients. We have technology tools both in the hospital and in the office, and monitoring devices that are used to take care of these patients too. And all patients have access to all kind of AFib treatments in Santa Rosa. Again, we strongly believe in tailored patient education in all phases of AFib management to support patients' perception of AFib and to improve their outcomes and improve their overall management for atrial fibrillation. We encourage patients to self-manage and be responsible for lifestyle changes. We usually believe in shared decision-making to ensure that the care is based upon the best available evidence and fits the needs, values, and preferences of the patients. Again, I'm looking forward to work with you all in treating your atrial fib patients, and thank you, I'll finish right here. Sorry for taking extra time, guys. Thank you so much. I'll take any questions.